Dear friends, today's seventh session, tremendously very ambitious program, but at the same time, we have achieved a lot in the last six sessions. We've gone from understanding about the basics of pain management, pain assessment, and we have concluded with managing opiates as well. Okay. So today's session, we have Dr. Pramesh joining us. So I'd like to invite him for a few minutes to deliver his thoughts. Dr. Pramesh is a man who I have the deepest admiration, a man of many talents, and he happens to be the node for India's cancer management, the way we are progressing and how he is bringing people together, institutions together is something to be watched with great admiration. He's a convener of the National Cancer Grid. We are very fortunate for him to associate his organization with this course. Thank you, Dr. Pramesh. Would you like to address the audience, which mainly comprises of oncologists from across India?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Aju, and thank you for inviting me to be part of this important session. Dr. Rajagopal and Aju discussed the possibility of the National Cancer Grid associating with this program. I think as an association, we were it was a very easy question to answer because we felt very strongly about getting pain control, being on the forefront of cancer care across the country. So over the last 9 years, the National Cancer Grid has strongly supported palliative care and pain relief across the NCG centers. We've gone on massive campaigns urging cancer center directors and leadership to embrace palliative care and pain relief. And I'm glad that something like this has come on and with such good participation from all of you. So 40 participants consistently attending seven sessions is not a mean task by any stretch of imagination, considering the kind of overload of virtual meetings that we currently have. And I think it's testimony to the fact that a lot of effort has gone into creating the content of this course. I do remember a lot of heated emails exchanged over what the course curriculum should be, what the course should contain. And again, it's reflective of the fact that the organizers of the course have left no stone unturned to ensure that participants get the best value for the time that they invest in it. And I think I'd earnestly request all the participants to encourage your colleagues in whichever center that you're working in to participate in future versions and editions of this course, because I see this course only getting stronger and better as time goes by. And like any other course, this will learn from its previous versions, previous editions, and come up with better versions of it as time goes by. As all of you know, pain control is something that is not very clearly prioritized in many of the cancer centers. And that's terrible, because what patients are worried about are symptoms and not stages of disease or what their CT scan shows. And unfortunately, as oncologists, we lose this perspective by treating scans and the disease stage rather than what the patient's symptoms should be. I think we all need a recalibration of our efforts to work towards patient-reported outcomes, what actually matters to a patient, and work towards that rather than just feel happier about seeing a scan showing a 7-centimeter tumor going down to a 4-centimeter tumor with no relief of symptoms for the patient. So pain is one of the most important symptoms that patients with many cancers have. And if we are unable to relieve this very simple symptom, I think as a community, we are failing our patients in addressing this very important problem. So I'm very, very encouraged by the fact that so many of you have consistently attended these sessions over the last seven sessions that this has been going on for. And I'm fairly certain that the success of this initiative will encourage more and more of your colleagues. And I'm very, very grateful to Dr. Rajagopal and Aju for having thought of and conceived this course and went ahead in spite of the challenges of the pandemic. So huge thank you to both of you and everyone else who's behind you, the team at Trivandrum Institute of Palliative Sciences, and everyone else who's worked towards putting this program together. Thank you very much.
Sir, sorry, my internet connection has been very sketchy. So thank you, Dr. Pramesh. I know you're a busy man, so I would not expect you to stay for the entire duration of the session. Over to you, Rajagopal sir, to lead. We have a long session today. We have lots of on the agenda. Over to you, sir.
But Aju, before Dr. Pramesh leaves, let me echo the sentiments that you expressed. If I understand the statistics correctly, as I said maybe on the first day, I have also 10% chance of getting cancer. And indeed, Dr. Pramesh, your efforts to bring attention to the suffering caused by cancer is indeed something that gives me hope for the future, for me, my loved ones, for all of us and our loved ones. So, Dr. Pramesh, thank you very much, particularly for joining today. And with those words, I would like to move forward. Friends, for the last 6 sessions, we have been talking mostly science. We started with a little bit about what palliative care is, and then from there we moved quickly on to the pathophysiology of pain. We did not go into the pain pathway or anything complicated, but we did talk about those aspects of pathophysiology that will make a difference to management, which helped us to understand that pain has to be treated. The earlier pain is treated, the better. That in all continuous pains, pain relief has to be continuous, and not this so is with pain being allowed to come in between, which would cause several changes in the nervous system, we said, including sensitization of the nervous system, causing self-propagation of pain. And then we talked about the ladder, about the various medicines, etc. But for a change, friends, this 7th session is no longer about the science of pain management. If I may share my screen, one point that I want to highlight from what Dr. Pramesh also said is that for that man and his wife, the suffering is the predominant factor, and say fear would be for me also. The suffering is often ignored in hospitals. It's not only really about cancer. Any hospital, we concentrate so much on diagnosis and treatment that we ignore the suffering. And indeed, pain is a major part of that suffering. When the particular importance is, though palliative care, as we said, is for physical, social, mental, spiritual suffering, pain can be so overpowering that it leaves no space for anything else. It occupies every moment of the person's life and worsens the psychosocial and spiritual issues. And to remind you about this document from ICMR, this is the only one that I have seen spelling out the doctor's duty of care, any doctor or any healthcare provider. The primary duty of care, which is not defined by law in this country, which is defined by law in many countries, including the UK, the primary duty of care is to mitigate suffering. This is clear sometimes, early often, and to comfort problems. There exists no exception to this principle. And if using all the science that we learned in the last 6 sessions, you want to relieve pain, and you know now the theory, you want to prescribe the medicines, and you find that it is not available. And unfortunately, doctors, nobody else is going to make it available. because it's very likely that in your institution, you are going to be the champion, the pioneer who will have been producing. And the rest of the institution, the current stage of development of pain management in India, you may find that the rest of the institution is not keenly interesting. But maybe you will have always a few people to join you. But the onus of making opioids available may rest on you, unfortunately. Hence, we are going to talk about a few regulations, a few forms to be filled up, a register to be kept, and what all we have to get done if your patient, that's me tomorrow, is to get paid. We mentioned the other during the earlier sessions that the WHO ladder has a step one with the non-opioids and adjuvants, which will lay the foundation for a pain, for management of more severe pain. Even if the pain is severe, we still usually work from this foundation. This is used by all clinicians, but you will use it scientifically. That means if you use paracetamol as this foundation, others may consider a laughable thing to do for severe cancer pain. If you use that foundation effectively by making sure that you are giving at least 12 milligram per kg per dose, 12 milligram per kg, which means for a, if you are 16 kg, the appropriate dose may be 1.5 tablets of 500. Given 4 times a day, most importantly, everybody prescribes everything GI. Paracetamol given 4 times a day in continuous pains, and judiciously, with caution, for the stomach and for the renal function, with the proton pump in which administered prophylactically, ensuring hydration in selected kinds of pain, including many bone pains where the inflammation may be the most important thing to control. You may use other non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medicines. Just to recapitulate, ibuprofen and naproxen are the two NSAIDs which are safe for the heart and the brain. Other NSAIDs, including the commonly used diclofenac, may increase the chance of a stroke or heart attack by as much as 5 times. In an incurable cancer, that may not be a such huge levels, but otherwise it is. So we'll start with this foundation, but thereafter we need the opioids. And as I have put in here, the palliative approach by all clinicians is to improve suffering.
Sir, I think some of your sound is not very audible. That was the few comments that I saw now.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Thank you, Sunil, for warning me. Is this any better now? Or is it still bad?
Sir, it is better for us.
Okay. Let me try something.
Please try if this is any better now.
It is now, sir.
I am glad. Thank you once more, Sunil. So as I just now said, we work with the foundation of paracetamol and other NSAIDs as judiciously and build on that with opioids. Of course, with the proper adjuvants in the foundation, including tricyclics for neuropathic pain or anticonvulsants for neuropathic pain, antispasmodics for smooth muscle spasm and so on. And to repeat, the opioids that you use as non-palliative care clinicians, non-specialist palliative care clinicians, is going to be the most important factor in relieving pain, because for the next 25 years, only a minority of patients are going to reach palliative care units. The most important fear among the public is about addiction. After this slide, we'll move directly on to the procedural and regulatory factors. But we all need to be aware, and we need to educate the public and the families and the patients that addiction is rare, especially in cancer. Withdrawal symptoms do not mean addiction. Withdrawal symptoms will occur if you stop opioids abruptly any time after 3 weeks of use. That may manifest as sleepiness, but also many symptoms, paradoxically, that mimic overdose of morphine, like disorientation, delirium, myoclonus, abdominal cramps. And abdominal cramps and diarrhea are a difference. So these are not indicative of addiction. Addiction manifests as craving for the substance, steadily increasing dose requirement, unsanctioned doses consumed by the patient, and behavioral changes. These are rare with oral morphine, and they are not a clinical problem with cancer. Not a clinical problem. Is that possible at all? Can addiction occur with oral morphine if used in cancer pain management? This, you may come across this question. Raju, can you administer the poll to the audience, please? Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for participating. I must admit that I will go with the minority. It is unlikely to cause addiction, but addiction is still a possibility. Addiction happens in mainly two settings. One, if it is a slow growing tumor, long-term administration in somebody with a genetic predisposition. We talked about genetic predisposition on only some people could have a genetic predisposed to addiction, and even in cancer, that's a possibility. The other is a very practical thing. In my palliative care practice, I came across two patients severe addiction problem. And one was to morphine, the other was to tramadol. Both unfortunately happened with an erroneous diagnosis of cancer. The histopathology report happened to be erroneous, and that caused a huge tragedy. So as we said, it is not a common problem, it's a rare issue. But it is an issue. Another possibility is, again, the rare possibility that your medical opioids may get diverted. So, in preparation to everything that we are going to talk now, let me bring up this principle of balance, which says that all of us have this dual responsibility. We are not going to promote use of opioids carelessly, because if we do, we can cause a major social issue. So we have this dual responsibility. Is that possible? Yes, it is certainly possible. All the Western European countries have demonstrated over decades and decades that the balance can be achieved. And in Kerala, over the last 24 years, it has been shown that the balance can be achieved. more than 170 institutions, sometimes small shop spaces in the middle of a market, stock and dispense opioids, and a two-year follow from one center in Calicut where we were has shown that it could be used effectively. Not even a single scandal has come so far in those 24 years of diversion. So this is what we will try to do today. We have already learned how to use opioids. Today we will talk about the regulatory procedures to be followed to ensure safe and uninterrupted access to opioids. Aha, there comes the problem. You get all the licenses, and after 3 months, the store's keeper may come and say, we have run out of morphine, there's no morphine. Few things can be as horrible as this for the patient who's been saved from drowning. It is as if he's put back into the water and suffocated. Whether we already have had it temporarily or not, we will have to assess the barriers to uninterrupted access and take remedial measures. And to ensure the principle of balance, we will have to ensure proper documentation. And we'll have to keep advocating for access to pain relief. So I am ready to go into the legal and procedural part of it. But does anybody want to comment or ask a question at this stage? Sunil, Raju, if there is a chat comment, will you bring it to my attention?
Okay, sir.
Somebody said something I could not hear.
No, I was saying I will.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, I assume that I can move on now. You see that huge, enormous book? That was the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act of India, the act which was created in 1985 with the intention of curbing abuse. And this was what got changed by the Indian Parliament in 2014 as a result of 19 years of efforts. And this amendment and the current procedures is what we will talk about. So many of you, if you have injection morphine, injection fentanyl, etc. in your hospital, many of you would still be going through this procedure. Not you personally, but your hospital will be still following the old rule. As a matter of fact, it is illegal now. From 2016, the old law has become invalid, but our country permits such things to happen, and many institutions, the old rules are continue to be followed, where the institution will need multiple licenses. Possession license, import permit, export permit by the manufacturer. You see why the terms import and export are used? It's still a hangover from British colonial days, where we had individual states as individual countries under the British umbrella. And it was import and export from country to country, which would mean from one princely state to another. And in Kerala, and except possibly in Maharashtra, which had slightly easier rules. Almost every state had this complicated rule where we have to have both the drug controller's office and the excise department and often the directorate of health service involved in the process. And we frequently found that by the time we had got the second one, the first one has expired validity. All this legally is a thing in the past. According to the new law, which came into being in 2014, all these licenses are not necessary. You don't need licenses. Every state now has a uniform law and uniform rules. States cannot any longer legislate for what are called essential narcotic drugs. Narcotic drug is not a very scientific term, but that is the legal parlance, and we will have to continue to use it. Essential narcotic drugs, or ENDs. Today and in future, you will keep coming across this phrase, essential narcotic drugs. Now, once your institution is approved as an RMI, recognized medical institution, and only one agency is required, you don't have to go to excise or anybody else. Once the state drugs controller approves your institution as an RMI, you need no other licenses. Your institution can order ENDs. So technically, this is a simple process. After today, you go to the hospital medical superintendent, even give him the necessary forms. The hospital applies to the drugs controller. You get RMI status. Then you just need to place an order with the manufacturer and make the payment. And the parcel will come to you. Theoretically, it is as simple as that. Practically, it is not often simple in many states because states still have not embraced the new law. Or if they have, it is still associated with several problems, unnecessary procedural tangles. Is this one point clear? If in your state the new rule is implemented already, if not, we'll have to try to get them to accept it. We have worked through that in so many states to get it approved. For example, Uttarakhand, Himachal Pradesh, West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, though not our efforts, Telangana. All these states have the new process, not to mention Kerala. But some states may not have, efforts will be necessary. But the point is, once your institution gets the RMI status, you order opioids like any other medicines. The medicines come to you. Of course, your documentation is not like any other medicine. It's not like documenting erythromycin. Here you need a process of documentation and reporting. Can I go on? Now, sorry to inflict this on, ladies and gentlemen, but one more technical point. In your mind, make a distinction between an act, ACT Act, the law, and rules. Make a distinction. They are not the same. The act is something created by a parliament or a legislative assembly. In this case, state assemblies no longer have the power to legislate. So as far as our opioids are concerned, the act was created by the parliament in 2014 that holds. Thereafter, the Department of Revenue of Government of India created the rules. Rules can be changed. Tomorrow, a new rule can be created. That can be changed only by the parliament. So what we are more concerned with now are the rules. There are important points about the law act, which would be good to know. But today I'm trying to keep it simple. According to the rules that are, according to the law, essential narcotic drugs are covered by the recognized medical institution status. If you are an RMI, your institution is an RMI, you do not need licenses for ENDs. What are essential narcotic drugs? From among the drugs that we are going to need, morphine, any formulation, injection, tablet, fentanyl, injection, transdermal, transmucosal, methadone, oral, injection. These three medicines, according to the current rules, are ENDs, essential narcotic drugs. What it means again is that if you have the status of an RMI for your institution, you can just place an order with the manufacturers for morphine, fentanyl, and methadone in any formulation available. And according to the new law and the new rules being enforced, any institution has to be a recognized medical institution for these three medicines. Though I acknowledge that the law is not followed in many states, legally, you need to be an RMI. Any question here? So, two new terms, RMI, recognized medical institution, END, essential narcotic drugs.
Sir, may I ask a question?
Yes, please.
So, if an institution provides fentanyl IV, they should automatically be able to provide tablet morphine also.
Yes. Okay. Unless that state is following the old law. Because in the old law, license had to be specific for a formulation. If the license said injection fentanyl, you couldn't buy transdermal. But in the new law, yes, absolutely. If, leave alone that, Aju. If you have any formulation of any one of these, if you have injection morphine in your institution, and but through the new law, then you can order any preparation of any of these medicines.
Sir, there is a chat question. Is there any license for a doctor in RMI who knows to prescribe morphine, for prescribing morphine?
Sorry, who did the question come from?
It's from Dr. Sujit.
Dr. Sujit, if your institution is an RMI, the individual doctor does not need a license. Clear no, capital no. But there is a provision, I am not going into that complicated provision, for an individual medical practitioner to have a small stock for his private practice. It is not practical. It is not used at all. So I will not go into that. But Dr. Sujit, the answer is no.
Another question is, do we need to renew the RMI status, and how long it's valid?
I will come to that later, but now that the question has come up. From Dr. Arun. Once you have got the RMI status, it is valid for 3 years. At the end of 3 years, you will have to renew it. The process of renewal is easy. That is, anyway, but there is one more requirement. Every year, you will have to submit the statistics. In each medicine, how much did you use? That will have to be sent to the drugs controller. And on the third year, in addition to the consumption report, you also apply for the renewal. I will show you the relevant forms.
So there are questions about the documentation. I think you will be coming to that.
I will be coming to the document.
Okay.
So there is a question regarding how do we apply for a new hospital to get the RMI status? Did you cover that? Okay.
I will come to that. I'll be coming to that. So, for this new hospital to have an RMI status, I will tell you how to apply. But one basic requirement is one doctor, MBBS or BDS, according to the rules, with training in pain management. That's what the rules say. One doctor in the institution should have training in pain management, then you can get RMI status. Now, neither the rules created by Department of Revenue nor the Ministry of Health of Government of India has spelled out what is the training. In fact, I understand that through National Cancer Grid, application is pending with the Ministry of Health to define it, to make it spelt out. But we will also tell you that in Kerala, so if the nature of the training is not spelt out, who will decide it? It's only the drugs controller. Because the application goes only to the drugs controller. Nobody else is involved. The drugs controller will have to decide. So if you give a certificate of training, say, I know what happens in Tamil Nadu, usually no questions are asked. It is given. But in many states, drug controllers are not familiar with it. But Kerala has come out with a specific order, which has said online training pipe in pain management is adequate. So perhaps what we can do is to code this. And the drug controller in Punjab will say, nothing doing. We will not go by the Kerala rules. We will ask for clarification from Government of India. These things can happen. So this is something that we have been trying to do for a long time. We will continue to do it. It would have happened already, a government order would have come, but the COVID problem would brought in obstacles. So this an answer to that question. If you have one doctor, the institution with training, the institution can apply to the drugs controller. And how the application is to be made, I am coming to in a moment.
So there's a question whether the current training that we are doing now, the 8 sessions, is that adequate, at least in Kerala, where
yes,
there's an approved
yes,
online training?
Yes, yes. In Kerala, by the letter of the order, an online training in pain management is acceptable. Kerala Drugs Controller many years back identified 7 institutions within the state as approved centers. So that makes it easier. But what I would recommend is that at the conclusion of this course, you just give this certificate of training and put in an application. And my guess is that the majority of states will accept it. But we are also making this offer. Please allow us to work with you. There will be objections brought in. And I'll tell you what are the usual objections brought in. Shall I move on?
Yes, sir.
So, after next week, when you have got a certificate of training, what we should do is to apply to the drugs controller with a covering letter to the drugs controller. Sir, madam, we are applying for such and such. So and so is trained. Ours is such and such an institution, etc. Ordinary covering letter. And though this is not in the rules, I would strongly recommend it. So when you apply, your institution may not be well known in the capital of the state, or it may be. So it would be wise if the drug center will say, who are you? Which institution? I have not heard about it. Better give a document right in the beginning. Say, like, we are a registered charitable trust. We would give a certificate away the deed which has allowed us to start the institution. Most states have different rules for registration and licensing of institutions. Wherever you are, your institution must have got some document from the state government or from a local body, some license, some proof of existence of the institution, that it is a genuine institution. This is not a legal requirement. I'm just making that recommendation from previous experience. Again, though it's not a legal requirement, better enclose your degree certificate of registration with the medical council, and certificate of palliative pain management training. If these things are given, then the objections will be less. And remember, if you apply, put in a satisfactory application, I would strongly recommend. You may know somebody in the drug controller's office, but rather than handing it over to that person, send it by registered post. Start a file with the copies of all the correspondence and keep the receipt in the file just as proof that this has been submitted, because legally, the drugs controller is supposed to either give you the RMI status or reject it showing adequate reason within 2 months. I am saying keep all this because let me tell you what happened in one state. I don't have to mention the name of the state. One state, nothing happened. After at the conclusion of 2 months, the doctor went and met the drugs controller. The drugs controller said, of course, no problem, we'll do it. And I agreed to do it. But next week, the doctor got a letter asking, it was not from the tax controller, from the next person, asking to submit a floor plan in the hospital and also certificate of registration by the National Board for Accreditation of Hospitals, NABH. So they were worried, and with their permission, what we did was, from our WHO collaborating center, we send a registered letter to the drugs controller. We understand that these two things were asked for. These are violating the law of the land. The amendment of the act was made to facilitate the access to opioids, and all necessary regulations have been put in place. But asking for NABH accreditation is not part of the rule. Asking for a floor plan is not a part of the rule. Obviously, there must be some misunderstanding. Please do the needful. There, within a week, it got done. In every state, it may not happen like that. I can think of some border states in the country where the problem is particularly bad and resistance is very high. But what I'm saying is, do this, and if it doesn't work within 2 months, let us continue to work at it through the formal official channels. We have to get it done. I'm going to show you some important forms, but our website, Palliative India website, also gives, this is the NDP, the government's website. The forms are given there. Dr. Nandini Vallath, a palliative care physician, has prepared this document best practices in using step 3 opioids. It's a very nice document, not complicated, very easy to go through. It's good to keep that also available as the reference. These two documents have been sent to you this morning by Rajalakshmi already. So, as I said, you send the application within 2 months. If you are in a state like Kerala or Tamil Nadu and many other states, you will get the approval. And once the approval is obtained, you place an order with the supplier. We can guide you to the suppliers also. But as somebody asked, what's the documentation required? This is important. This is important legally, but also ethically. Because as I said, we have the responsibility to make sure that nothing gets into the street. So, Raju, can I request you? Raju, I will have to come back to you with a question a bit later. But Raju, you are there?
Yes, sir.
Can you share the forms that I mentioned, starting with the Appendix 5 of the NDPS rules? Can you blow it up a little bit? Make it a bit larger if that's possible? Zoom in? Okay. I'm not going into, this is the only form about which I'll speak in some detail. Number one, no problem there. Postal address, etc., etc. Name of the head in charge of the institution, not your name. The principal or head of medical superintendent or director or whoever it is. Just something that was not very relevant. How many staff were employed by the hospital? I have not seen of a single drug inspector, drug controller verifying this, and number of patients during the previous calendar year. If it is a new hospital, please note this down. This is a new institution. You have just joined the institution. Previous calendar year, there were no patients. Just write new institution. That's all. Now, in category of RMI, write palliative care. Okay. So they are not for opioid substitution therapy, not the direct administration, which is for individual doctors holding it, palliative care. Your name goes in here as the qualified medical practitioner. Well, you have a choice to include one more person or many more people. If they are there in our institution, I'll tell you, I am the doctor who is registered. My name is given. In the beginning, whoever was there also was put in. But that's important. This one person is most important. It is that person's certificate that has to be given. And next row, if you had a RMI certificate issued earlier, give the number. Raju, can you scroll down, please? If it was withdrawn earlier, that has to be mentioned. And this has to be submitted by register first. Raju, please scroll up. Scroll up, please, again. So as you can see, the only important things are the name of the head of the institution, your name. Scroll down a little bit, please. And that's it. This is the application form. And as I said, if it's a new institution, you just say new institution and that's it. This is about the application form. Does anybody want to ask a question about this form per se? Raju, the Appendix 7, please. Okay. legally, this is the form which has to be kept for every patient. So if you are treating only two patients, it's okay. Just fill up the form. But I'll tell you what we do. Raju, can you show the copy of the register that we keep? So instead of all these details, what we do is we enter into a register which in the beginning here the quantity received is entered in red, quantity dispensed is entered with the patient's name, age, registration number, etc., and the quantity dispensed. If for each formulation a separate register is kept, 10 milligram tablet, one book, 20 milligram tablet, one book, or you can keep separate pages of each same register. We keep separate registers. So fentanyl injection is a separate register. This is how we keep it. Again, this has been sent to you this morning by Raju. And as you have seen, in the last column, the doctor in charge signs. Raju, one more. Can you show Appendix 14, the order for purchase? These are the three forms that you will need now. Everything else comes later. After you have, for application for the RMI, this is the only thing. I told you of a covering letter and some certificates to be attached and this form. Now, once you get the RMI certificate, use this form, fill it up, mention the name, the drug and the quantity, and just order it up to the manufacturer. Raju, please scroll down. That's it. Raju, please stop the screen share. You may have to come back to the forms if there are questions, but I thought it's good to see each other and one another and talk. Before I invite questions, Anju, I have a question to you. See, suppose you overcome all these problems, and I know that in Kolanjeri, you have the RMI status, you have the medicines. You do all this, do you find that the patients are unwilling or family is unwilling to take morphine?
Absolutely, sir. A lot of our patients, forget patients, families, they are afraid that prescribing morphine or taking it actually is a sign of the end of life, which is sort of partly correct. But their fear is it causes addiction. They have a stigma with taking morphine. So it's a major challenge. And it's a challenge that I'm sure a lot of us are experiencing. I don't know how to take care of this. I don't know how to dispel the problems and the myths. But please, sir.
Yes, Raju. I just asked that because we want to bring that also into the discussion. And we also face the same. In fact, among the educated people, the fear is more. The most important thing is, most of the time, the incurability in incurable disease has not been explained. And they are worried about that is the end of life. And sometimes you need it even before the diagnosis. Even the patient whom I referred to you sometime back was on opioids. And she needed, before the diagnosis was final, because she had severe pain. And in such cases, we just explain to the patient. Some people will continue to be afraid. And I'll also tell you when they are going to be afraid. If there is another doctor or nurse in the family, they will be very worried. Because most doctors themselves discourage patients from using it. Having said all that, vast majority of patients with explanations accept it. For the minority, our continued advocacy and best practices being followed will be necessary. Ajay, thank you for validating that real problem. So, questions from the audience now?
So Dr. Dottala has a few questions. Dr. Dottala, am I pronouncing your name right, by the way?
Dr. Dotla Mahadev, how many days can you give? Fortunately, the law does not specify that in our country. There is no law saying that you can give only so much. So, I'll tell you what our current practice, almost everyone in Kerala follows this. Ordinarily, we give 2 weeks supply. Ordinarily. But if they are coming from far away, we have patients coming from Tamil Nadu. We may give for 3 weeks or at the most for 1 month. Not more than 1 month. We never give. So legally, there is no restriction. But because we believe in the principle of balance, to be on the safe side, we limit it to 1 month. Can we, Dr. Hemant Das, can we prescribe to proxy? Old patient not come for consultation, absolutely. I mean, this is almost mandatory. Imagine most patients, they come from faraway villages and they are too sick to travel and they are in pain and the travel will be agony. So again, there's nothing at all in the law which says it can be only given to patients directly. You can give it to a family member. You can give it to a authorized representative. I know that there are some states in West Bengal. Unfortunately, this is something that we are trying to change. They insist on the Aadhaar card, etc. That's also not a legal requirement. Those are discouraging factors. So no limit on number of days, no limitation in giving it to proxy.
Sir, if I work in a hospital that doesn't have RMI, I have a patient, can I write a prescription that the patient can then go to a hospital with an RMI, and if that hospital permits, just dispense it?
That hospital will have to register the patient and will have to write a valid prescription. That will be that responsibility. So Aju, when you wanted methadone for one of your patients, what we did was, we registered the patient and Sunil actually wrote out a prescription. Sunil had not seen the patient, but we saw the patient through you. There is nothing in the law that says that it is not possible. So if you trust somebody, you can do that. And Dr. Mahadev also asked, without seeing old patient, can we prescribe same dose of morphine or different dose? Yes. What we usually do is, if we have twice, thrice, and then the family is coming back, not the patient, we would ring up the patient directly. Or sometimes for a patient in Tamil Nadu, it was going on for 4 months. We had not seen the patient. And the family member would come. We actually requested a friend, a doctor in that city to see the patient. So there is no legal problem, but we need to be sure in our mind that somehow validity is established.
Dr. Sujit, would you like to ask the question?
Okay. Sir, I wanted to ask the pharmacy in charge, are they legally involved in documentation? Because what we see is they are also very much, I know they are also very much keen to keep the records, but they also have some role in maintaining the records as per the law?
Dr. Sujit, in the hospital, the usual system goes on. I'll tell you what happens in our place. The pharmacist keeps all the records. The register that I showed you a copy of is kept by the pharmacist. But I have the responsibility to make sure, periodically check and make sure that everything is okay. It may not be a clerical error, can happen. So once in a way, if you are in charge, Dr. Sujit, you should check the register. You should check to see if the register is kept properly. That's all we need to do. So it is not practical for you to dispense some morphine. So whoever is available, There was a time when we did not have a full-time pharmacist. Then our nurse kept the record, but I would still check it. Dr. Hemant, your question is separate prescription for narcotic drugs. Not a separate prescription. I may have prescribed 5 drugs. Sunil prescribes 5 drugs. One of them is morphine. That's okay. The patient has to have that with him. And you in your case records or a file or somewhere would keep that prescription also. So there is nothing in the law says that it is a separate sheet of paper for morphine alone. But a valid signed prescription kept in your hospital, which may be in the patient's file, or one with the patient is a must.
Oh, I didn't realize that there should be a prescription with the patient also. For instance, in my hospital, I write it and the prescription is maintained in the hospital file. The patient just goes with the instructions written. The prescription copy should be there?
Yeah, prescription copy is necessary. Someday, in the bus, something goes wrong. Or a dog, excise department's dog comes and smells. I mean, I think they need it for their protection. How do we write the prescription? Just like any other prescription, doctor. More than one copy, the patient carries the prescription. You have it entered in your file. So that means one is with you, one is with the patient. That's enough.
Sir, what happens if patient passes away and a patient dies and then they have a bunch of morphine lying in the home? Are they legally obliged to return it? If they bring it, how do we keep it? What do we do with it?
Legally they are not bound to, not legally. And some people actually throw it into a funeral pyre. But we encourage our patients' families to bring it back. When they bring it back, we enter it into the register as an authorized incoming stock and use it. If we don't use it if it is broken or anything, but otherwise we use it.
So Dr. Kannan has a question. All registered medical practitioners, can they prescribe essential narcotic drugs?
Dr. Kannan, there is a bit of a problem with the current rules, which we are still waiting for it to be changed. Now, it came in accidentally, but I'll tell you what is in practice. If Dr. Kannan, you are the authorized doctor, you authorize your assistants to prescribe. In any teaching hospital, in All India Institute of Medical Sciences, the same thing happens. The head of the department may be the doctor named. They authorize anybody. So, Dr. Kannan, you can authorize anybody. There, I would admit that there's some ambiguity in the rules, the way it is phrased, but the whole country practices it that way. But you have to authorize people. And it is not to be limited to your department. If you authorize a surgeon also to prescribe, provided they also follow the same documentation, that's fine. Interns and resident doctors, same answer, provided you are confident that they have been taught how to do it. Because there's something else I may have missed, something in the top. Sunil, will you keep scanning the chats earlier? If the patient says he has lost it, what I would do is to document it and issue him more tablets. I'll write in the file that this has been lost. I'll watch it, because lost medicine is a typical sign of addiction or diversion. Stolen, sometimes they will tell stories that nobody can believe. More than one unsanctioned dose escalation, more than one report of loss is a red flag. Watch it.
Sir, are we legally liable if morphine is misused by patient or relatives? I have a interesting small anecdote, sir. I prescribed morphine for a patient, a lady in severe pain who's paralyzed. Her daughter once saw her popping in the entire 30 tablets together. So, you know, brought her to the hospital immediately. And, you know, we gastric lavaged her, we saved her. So it gave me a scary moment because it was a prescription that I gave and the patient attempted self-harm.
One word answer is no, you are not liable. If you have given a valid prescription following the rules, you are not liable for abuse. But the problem will be if the prescription is not valid. Suppose we have scribbled something illegible, etc., that may create a problem because there may be an inquiry someday. Secondly, I have known of two attempted suicides. Now, today, since 2018 in our country, suicide is not a crime anymore. So all that we need, we don't even have to report to the police. All that we need to do is to document it in the file. This story is like this. And you naturally take a precaution. If the person has attempted it or if a family member has attempted, thereafter the youth will have to follow some precaution, which may be direct administration by a responsible relative, not to give custody to the person. Dr. Jobin, yes, it is mandatory to have one prescription in the hospital. One goes with the patient, one is with the hospital. That is not necessarily, that's your entry in the file is enough. In the patient's case records, you have written such and such a dose, so much. That's your prescription in the hospital. Of course, in the pharmacy, they would enter it in the register, say how much has been prescribed. That will be based on your prescription, how much has been dispensed. Lethal dose for morphine. A bit difficult to say, Dr. Mahadev, but let me tell you this. With oral morphine, 10 milligram tablets, it is very difficult to commit suicide. You can attempt. I have seen it in the attempted suicide cases that I mentioned and one accidental. See, what the limiting factor is, when you swallow a handful of tablets, you have to swallow some water. After some time, you feel so full that you stop or you vomit. That's the protective factor. But suppose you are using 50 milligram tablets. They are eating a handful of 50 milligram. Then it can be lethal. But then what happens? The patient becomes unconscious, gets taken to the hospital. And usually, almost invariably, opioid overdose is easy to treat. Even if you do not have the antidote, the medicine to treat it with, that's okay. The patient will be artificially ventilated for 24 hours and they will go out. So it is very difficult to commit suicide using opioids. It's so much easier to commit suicide with most other things. With morphine, it's only as difficult as it is with paracetamol.
So Dr. Sunil has a question.
Yes, Dr. Sunil. Mandatory to take approval of the in-charge for prescribing of opioids. In-charge means the Dr. Sunil, if you are the in-charge of the RMI, you authorize 5 people. You are confident that
yes,
they are
the doctor.
Okay. And the pharmacy also knows that such and such people are authorized, but only they. If any doctor who doesn't understand opioids, you have a problem. So that's an arrangement that you have to make and a responsibility that you accept, that you designate doctors for using morphine. Like in my institution, as I said, I am the responsible physician and 7 doctors prescribe it. Dr. Sunil is the one. I'm not even going to make sure that the junior most doctor is trained enough. Dr. Sunil makes sure that everybody is adequately empowered before they prescribe it.
So no questions.
I realize that it's 10 minutes past time. Next session is going to be done by Dr. Veena. I think she is here with us. And if there are any questions pertaining to this also, that too we'll handle at the next session. But I'll make this one appeal to you. This is not a journey for you to take alone. We are familiar with this opioid journey. In some states that travel is easy, in the some states that travel is complicated. Let us walk with you and let us get this done together.
We would be happy to host people at our center if they would be interested, right?
Very good. Of course, of course. We are only worried about the COVID thing.
COVID.
But as soon as the stage is over, do please come.
Thank you. Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if any chat questions have been missed.
Sir Anula, nothing else, sir.
No.
Thank you. Thank you so much, everybody. Please, do you do free for consultation? Sir, do you do free consultation?
There is nothing legally for or against it. We don't. Our institution provides free treatment. There is no fee. If anybody is capable of paying and they say, anybody who asks me how much is the fee, I will say, we don't have a billing system. But at least pay twice as much as you would have paid in an ordinary hospital so that we can give free treatment to a patient. We accept donations. We don't bill. But if you are in a corporate place or any trust hospital even, there is absolutely no difference between the rules for paying patients and non-paying patients.
So I think he meant is if we provide consultation for helping him get RMI status, is there a fee for our charge?
I think
what he meant is if we are providing service to help people in this group to get the RMI status, is there a consultation fee for our services?
No. You will be doing us a favor by allowing us to help, because our Palliative India's mission is to improve access to palliative care all over the country. Absolutely no fee. It will be a privilege to work with you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajagopal sir, for that very valuable talk. Thank you, colleagues. Please do fill the form, feedback form. And session 8 will be led by Dr. Veena. Look forward to meeting her and having all of you together again.
Veena, do you want to unmute and say hello to everybody?